something some of you may have seen already. If you have, feel inspired by what we have suggested, we have a global call for sharing that we are collecting email addresses. That's eventually going to go to the UN. If you would like to sign that, that would be wonderful. So Sonia will pass those around. If you could write, if you're going to sign, please write your email address really clearly, because we need to type this in, so we need to be able to read it. There's also a box at the end if you would like to ask to inform you when we're going on demonstrations. And you can come and actually march with us, quite literally under a banner of Article 25. So tick that box also if you'd like to, us to email you with that information. Are they going round now? Yeah. Thank you. Is there a roving mic? Yes. Yes, please. The person at the back there in the white t-shirt.
Thank you, that was illuminating. I wonder, the argument that we should share resources equally, if you put that to the average government, take our government, they would say, yes, but profit is important because that benefits us all. So they put profit before people, that's how I feel it anyway. So what is the counter argument to that? Because if we say, let's distribute resources, they will say, well, then there's no profit, companies will disappear, and we'll be poorer than ever. So how do we counter that?
Thank you for that.
Do you want to answer that? Yeah, happy to answer that. What you've said is very much about the trickle-down effect that you know, the governments have been talking about for many, many years now. And we've not seen any of the trickle-down effect, really. If you're looking at the world as it is today, things are actually getting worse rather than better. And, a statement that we're hearing again and again, you know, about a few people that are rich and, you know, most people that are sort of getting worse off by the day, really. So the trickle-down effect is not happening, so that argument, I think, no longer stands, really. And, you know, the resources of the world belong to all of us, don't they? They don't just belong to one government, they belong to all of us. And only when we start sharing those resources equally amongst the nations, you know, can we actually start building a future for all of us. Does that answer your question?
Yes, partially. I agree with you, of course. Somebody next to me mentioned the trickle-up effect. It would be nice if it was.
But what I'm trying to play the devil's advocate, they say, okay, let's share resources, but all the main companies have gone, and we're going to get another financial crash, and all everything's crashing, and where's the production? Production is going to go lower, and I hate all that talk. But sadly, money is what makes the world at the moment. So how do we find another effective way of sharing resources without seeing those resources just draining away somehow, according to the current economic paradigm? So how do we counter with rational, their own arguments, as it were? How do we say, yes, but we will still keep some money going for the time being?
I would say the money will still, of course, have to circulate for now. We'll probably see a future, you know, a distant future where money will no longer be necessary. But for now, of course, money will have to circulate. But it's all about living simpler, first of all, to reduce the resources that we're actually using from our planet. It's a matter of, different companies can, you know, sort of arise out of that. You know, obviously something that is much greener, something that actually looks after the planet, something that recycles in a way that it's actually, you know, the moment the way we are recycling is not very efficient, really, is it? So, you know, there are different companies. There are so many wonderful people out there with wonderful ideas, but they have not been really given the chance to actually implement those. So industries will come out of that, and they will continue, but on a very, very different level.
Mm-hmm. Thank you. Yeah. Yes, the person
at the red top there. I mean, it sounds brilliant. It's a real utopia, really. I'm just wondering, do you have any kind of billionaires or organisations that are kind of on board with you? And also, second part, are there any examples of the universal basic income? I have a feeling Switzerland are sort of looking into it, or?
Switzerland had a referendum, or they put it to the people. The people actually said no, But we met in Portugal, we met Elo Schmidt, who he engineered that, he was in charge of that. And he said actually that happens usually when something is put to the public in that way. It takes three consecutive referendums before it goes through. And I think they had 23% saying yes, which is actually quite high for a first attempt. Yes, there are trials going on, I think, and there's some in Scotland.
Canada, India, so they're happening in various places of the world.
But what we're suggesting is that once the world's resources are redistributed to where they are needed, and then all the necessary infrastructure can be set up with health services and social services and so on, then the basic income would become not just the next step, the next logical step, it would actually become inevitable as a way of ensuring that the entitlements in Article 25 could be met. You asked about, do we have any billionaires on board?
I don't
know. We're talking very much of this, about this being a people power movement. This has to come from the people. We need to make our governments change. We can't leave it up to them. So this is about building a movement, an ongoing movement that we sustain until we make our governments take on Article 25.
Which one do you want?
Yes.
Oh, yeah, sure.
There you go.
Well, I remember back in 2014, we were discussing the universal basic income, and at the time, Oxfam actually published that there were 80 billionaires actually have as much resources as the poor 3.5 billion. Now it's turned out to be 8 billionaires having as much wealth as the poorest 3.5 billion people in the world. So at some point, something has to give. You can't just say, oh, at some point it will trickle down. You can't just wait for the billionaires to start pissing down on you in order to actually get some of that resources. It's not going to happen. So something will have to give, and then we'll places like this will actually have to find the answers for it. And yes, there's actually basic income part of the manifesto, and we're still, remember the last time it was actually published, a lot of the media did actually criticize it, saying £80 a week is not enough. But then we need to actually make that more palatable, and then hopefully the main parties will actually investigate and actually copy it wholesale into their manifesto. And then, yeah, but we need to make that not just for this country, but also around the world. Then that's going to be the real challenge.
Thank you.
That was very interesting. I think that is being discussed widely as well, and a lot of people are actually concerned about that. And that is where we again are saying, well, how high should the basic income actually be to really, you know, make the difference that it should make? So even in this room, if we imagine, let's say, 500 or, let's be generous, £1,000 a month, I mean, how far would that really get you if that is all you're getting? So all your social services are coming out of that, your rent is coming out of that, your food is coming out of that, your clothing, children, education, etc. It would not really get us very far. And that is where our argument goes back again to Article 25. Unless we've got the basic needs met, you know, basic income, you know, is not going to be a lasting solution, unfortunately.
You want to go?
Someone in the front.
Can I suggest that in part of the way we can deal with this is to change the metaphor? Because right now the metaphor is that there's a pot of money and somebody important is controlling that pot and deciding, oh, this money has to go in this place, and this, if it goes there, it can't go there. What I suggest, we have to change the way we think about money, and then we can change the way we communicate about. If we think of it, one suggestion is to think of it as blood in the body. Blood must flow. If it stays in one place, you get an aneurysm, you get a blood clot. But it's true that some parts of the body need more blood than other parts, and some parts need more blood at certain times than other times. I don't know if that's a good metaphor, but if we think of it as something that's flowing, and that is part of a whole system, and we start to communicate about money and wealth as something which is not a thing in itself, which we know it isn't. It's just, it isn't. It's not a thing. It's electronic digits somewhere. And we think of it as a way of flow of basic wealth and access to things. And then we can change the way people think about that. Then it's easier to communicate the idea that a universal basic income is therefore just a way of keeping the flow, whereas it's no different than when they do quantitative easing but then give a whole lot of money to the banks because somebody at the top is controlling this pot and deciding that this money from this pot must go to that pot, and that pot's how it all kind of keeps the bank going, and we know that doesn't work. But if it isn't somebody at the top controlling, but sort of dams being opened so that the flow can happen, and then it's the same money, it's the same resources. It's not taking money from one to give to another. It's just making sure that the flow is flowing. And we think of it like that, that we can communicate it like that. There's not these obstacles to get over, like, well, we're going to get the money to pay bill.
Thank you very much. It's actually a very good analogy, really. But I think to create that flow that you're talking about, it needs the people.
Yes.
You know, it needs the people of the world to demand that flow. And without the people, it will just not happen. You know, just lobbying a political party, for example, it will not be enough. It really, literally does take millions of us to demand it. Especially the way things are standing at the moment, where governments are working very, very closely with big corporations who actually are sort of enforcing certain laws. It needs the people.
Someone has
had
that
little
time here.
Black T-shirt. Thanks. It's a question. You talked about the corrupting power of corporations and globalization and so on. And then you talk about a global movement of people, which sounds like a brilliant idea, getting loads of people all around the world on board with this thing. How do you stop corrupting influence of globalization from corrupting the movement itself, from taking those ideas and putting their own spin on it, and then basically destroying it? But if you think about things like communism, for example, you know, it's a globally organized movement that was destroyed by corrupting influences, I think.
The way I see this is that this is about humanity responding from the heart about how we need to be caring for one another, and that people who get involved in the movement are people who, you know, people want to share. I don't know if this is answering your question, but I'm not sure how about the corruption of the movement. But what I'm seeing is people out on the streets demanding justice, demanding an end to inequality, because that's what we want to do, because we're responding to people from our hearts. I don't know how to answer that question.
No, it's a tricky one, but I think, you know, if the call is, like Victoria says, it comes from the heart, you know, and it's really heartfelt, you know, it will actually infect others. You know, we've heard it so often in sort of recent demonstrations, well, maybe not so recent, but for example in Turkey, there were big demonstrations, and some people went to the streets that have never ever gone to the streets before, because that was not their thing, but this time they felt compelled. And there was a very moving story of a woman who said, you know, she's never ever felt so much love, you know, as being part of this huge movement asking for, you know, a good cause. And I think, you know, good causes, you know, they can be infectious, and once we realize what we can actually achieve with this, you know, it's going to be very difficult to corrupt, you know, because there will be more of us than of those that want to corrupt. But I can see where you're coming from, because anything that is good usually, you know, sort of gets a block.
Someone back there,
hand up
for one.
Surely the elephant in the room is that it will make us all lazy and even more selfish and apathetic, because we don't have to work. This is the argument I can hear. Even from very left-wing-minded people, that's what they'll say. We need the competitive, we even need an enemy in order to create and to build and be dynamic. I've heard these arguments, so that's really, I don't know if that's explained it, but basically the good
and
lazy.
Argument, Yes. Interestingly, something that I heard quite a lot when we were in Portugal from people reporting back on the trials is that people outside of the trials assume that people who get this basic income will become, just as you say, lazy and not want to work. But what they're actually finding is that once people have got their basic needs met, people are actually working more. They are becoming more creative, more engaged with their communities. The effects that I didn't hear any negative effects at all, but this is what we were hearing. So that's from the trials that are happening. And the kind of thing that you're suggesting that you're hearing is from people who've been outside of it.
I'm not agreeing. I mean, I'm a whole 100% with you. That's the argument.
Yeah, yeah.
But hopefully that's what the trials also will prove, sort of internationally, that actually having a basic income is not making people lazy. You know, they might take a little bit of time out, but then they actually go back and contribute.
I'm Clive Ward. And I sometimes joke that I invented the Green Party. I didn't. It had been formed 3 months before I joined in 1973. However, I did invent the basic income before I knew that anybody else had thought of the idea. It had been thought of before. Now, my reason for introducing this was quite traumatic. The four founder members of the Green Party had founded it purely in answer to the Limits to Growth study, which said the world was heading for disaster because economic growth was trashing the planet. So I, as an inquirer of the group, I said to the four founding members, you're talking about recession then, we're getting rid of it. Oh, we won't call it a recession, we'll call it a steady state economy. Will you stop using that phrase? I said, well, it will be a recession. It will just be an earlier planned recession instead of a recession that's going to happen if we trust the public. And they said, I said, what are you going to do when people, start getting desperate? Martial law. If you've got a better idea, they said to me, if you've got a better idea than martial law, you better come up with it fast. Well, I came up with it on the way home from that meeting. I joined the Green Party on the spot. So it must be, my reason is so that everybody can think about limiting economic activity to what the planet can stand. Now, that is not, I'll tell you one thing, I was in Portugal with you, and I'll tell you the thing that worried me most, is that there was only one speaker who saw this connection at all. You've got guys standing there who says, one of the good things about basic income is it will encourage economic growth. You know, this terrifies me.
Thank you very much.
Another population. Now, obviously, the Green Party started being worried about overpopulation. The way I would see this is that we've got to get to a situation where every woman everywhere has copied the same confidence that women in Britain have that their first two children will survive. Now, politically, that's unrealistic. Breeze Mugger there saying we've got to stop giving aid at all to third party countries. But the final practical point I want to say, are you aware of the existence of the world basic income movement? Because it seems to me that you and them should be doing the same. So two separate, apparently separate organisations, they're doing the same thing.
Very well spotted. We've actually been to their first conference in Manchester last year. So, yes, thank you very much.
Thank you. Yes.
Thank you. One thing I thought could bring up is there's a workshop going on migration. I thought actually this ties in with the migration idea. It could be a way of getting through to people that actually it's in everyone's benefit. People can stay in their countries and sort of live with their families and not have to move because they are being starved out. So therefore that will actually stabilise all this mass migration that's going on around the world. And so it's in the benefits of everyone to do this.
Yes.
I think that is one way of getting across it, because otherwise we'll think, oh, we're just giving money to them. In fact, it's in the benefit of everyone.
Absolutely.
So,
yes, very well said, yes. People want to stay in their own country. countries. They leave because they feel, you know, because of dire situations. Yeah, thank you. Yes.
Thanks very much. That's Stuart Lane, South East, Dorset, England. I can see the aspirations are fantastic, and my business brain, cynical brain, is looking at the chinks in the armour, and one was exactly that point. I can see corporations, if this gathers momentum, looking at an opportunity for economic growth, and it doesn't, you haven't mentioned a mechanism for fending off those predators, if you like. If this does gain traction, that's an obvious opportunity for business, and they will be on.
Are you talking about Article 25 or about basic income?
About basic income. And what, you know, what safeguards can be built in to defend against that? And another chink, I suppose, is the sharing of assets. So it's all very well to have a basic income, but if a proportion of the world owns the assets and the other proportion is buying, is renting the space or buying the food that they can't grow on their own land because the land's owned by someone else. So it's not an equal situation, is it? And how do you include assets into that equation as well?
To answer it before, that you said about corporations taking advantage, this is exactly why we are arguing that Article 25 has to be in place first. If we were to have basic income schemes just on their own, without that, then they would corrupt. I'm sure they would corrupt within, you know, given length of time under globalisation and commercialisation. But if we had Article 25 in place all around the world as fundamental law, then governments would have to address the needs of their people. If it was fundamental law with the power of the people and public opinion behind it, and most likely the UN involved as well in ensuring that every country makes sure that countries are fulfilling Article 25, then the governments would have to be looking at the needs of the people first rather than pandering to the corporations and so on. So it would be a natural thing that would happen. But that's why we're saying we need Article 25 first, exactly your point there. Once that's there, then basic income comes in as a way of making sure people can have their needs met, because there will be the resources will have been shared and they can access healthcare. Access social services and so on. So I think that would naturally happen, but that's why Article 25 is the key to pave the way, and then once it's there, then basic income would follow. Do you want to say the one about assets, sharing assets?
Well, that again comes under the banner of Article 25, because once it is implemented, and again, once the governments of the world are working together, that completely falls away, you know, because you're actually working hand in hand rather than, you know, sort of just making profit out of one another as such. So there will be a very sort of different sense of mind. Does that make sense to you in a nutshell? If basic income was to be implemented without Article 25, then definitely we wouldn't have to worry about everything that you've just mentioned. It will last for a short period of time.
This is from the NHS demo a few weeks ago. We were there with our Article 25 banners, and people really got it. We talked to a lot of people there. They were very interested. A lot of people taking photos and banners, and they really understood. We had a lot of really good responses. Anyone else? Yes.
Thank you very much. Just a quick response to that. Corporations are already exploiting the environment for profits, and I don't see sharing the world's resources necessarily as a solution to that. If it does become a solution somewhere down the line, that's amazing. But in the meantime, I think it's a great solution to social problems, such as poverty, like lack of access to healthcare, famine, malnutrition. And now to my question. First of all, amazing and moving speech. appealing, but I get stuck down in the practical applications of it. So I wondered if you'd kind of given any consideration to practical questions such as how will we distribute the resources, will they be raised through a tax, and then will they be distributed at a national level or at a global level, and then will different people from different countries receive different amounts of money based upon needs? Because obviously a dollar in somewhere like Namibia will go a lot further than a dollar in the US. And even in like England, a pound in London is nothing compared to a pound up north.
Of course, yeah. We know, to answer the first part, we haven't looked at the nuts and bolts of how basic income would be administered, but what we're not suggesting that there would be a global basic income that is administered from one central place. Each country, each nation would have to do that for themselves. You know, the government within each nation would work out what the needs were within their own country, which is obviously going to be different from one country to the next. But with Article 25 in place, this is, you know, coming back to that again, this is the whole point of this, that would be the benchmark that would say, you know, people need food, shelter, healthcare, social security, so each government would work out what that means for their people. You know, so we haven't done that costing ourselves.
I do have to add on that is that, you know, we are looking towards the UN as a headquarters, so to speak, obviously a very different UN from what we're seeing today. And, you know, where people of different countries come together and discussing the various needs these countries have. So obviously, like you said, you know, somebody in Uganda will have a very, very different need than from somebody, let's say the UK. So it will have to be done on national levels, but through the UN, you know, people will be able to sort of help each other to achieve what needs to be achieved.
Yeah. My name's Robert Ashby from Brighton and Hove Green Party. A couple of points. One is that one of the acknowledged leading thinkers in the world has just recently published a book which seems to be running totally contrary to your proposition, which is Steven Pinker's book, Enlightenment Now, which basically says that we've never had it so good, that there have been dramatic improvements in the quality of life, particularly over the past 200 years, and that he says, is going to go on going on. In other words, if you present the proposition too much as an issue about doom and gloom and how life is getting worse, an awful lot of scientific information is actually contrary to that in terms of the quality of life on average of people around the world. I thoroughly support the BMI proposition, I'm very intrigued on in this tactic of using Article 25 potentially. Have you identified any country in the world that is likely to be the first to actually implement BMI on the basis of Article 25? Is there anybody that you think is going in that direction? I mean, obviously, the obvious choice is potentially Finland, but is there anyone else?
Well, Scandinavia has always been ahead of the game. You know, they've always looked after their populations much better than any other countries really around the globe. So yes, Finland might very well be the first one, or any other Scandinavian country. But you know, we in the UK, you know, for example, we've had a wonderful system going, you know, which is now rapidly sort of declining. The same in other parts of Europe. So you could say part of Article 25 has been met, you know, by European standards or, you know, the better off countries. But when you say we've never had it so well, yeah, to a certain degree, I could agree. Of course, you know, we've come a long way from where we were, let's say, 200 years ago, even 50 years ago. But I think some people in, you know, in Sudan who are dying of hunger today might not agree with you. So yes, we've had it much, much better. But we need to share these resources. We need to share it globally. You know, we need to share it with these poor nations so they can have an adequate standard of living. At the moment, I mean, the way they're living, you know, it's very, very far removed from other goods. So yes, we've had it definitely better, but some people definitely will not agree. And many people are dying just as we speak right now.
Good. Oh.
Thank you. Hi, I'm David Finn.
things around animal protection. Since joining the Green Party 3 years ago, and since becoming vegan 2 years ago, my whole thinking as a humanist changed immensely. I really get this, I really like it. Forgive me, I came in late to your talk, so you may have covered some of this. My question is twofold. One, how do animals fit into this? Are they within the scope? And also, how do you feel about the UN's recommendation that we proceed towards a plant-based diet in view of the cattle methane issue?
We've got a fellow vegan here, so...
How do I answer that? I mean, for me, I'm looking at the world as a whole, as an interconnected being, as I already said. That includes humans, animals, plant life, the planet, the biosphere. I'm talking about the whole of the globe. So yes, it will include animals. Eventually, when we are, I'm hoping, eventually when we are living together as one united humanity, as we should be, in right relationship with one another, that will also extend to the animal kingdom and the environment. And yes, in terms of plant-based, it was about a plant-based diet. What was the actual question about?
The United Nations report that recommended we progress towards a plant-based diet because of the issue of cattle methane. Imposing heavily on climate change, 28 times more power in big emissions, I think they said. So that's the other question.
Okay, thank you. Yes, I think there's a lot about animal agriculture that impacts on climate change. I learned quite a lot about it when I went to the climate talks a couple of years ago, and learned a lot there about how animal agriculture is, in fact, in more ways than just the methane, is contributing to climate change. You know, more than fossil fuels, even some people would say. So, personally, I'm with you. I think it would be great if we move towards eating less meat. Yes.
But I think it will automatically change. You know, once we actually truly share with one another, as Victoria was saying, we are one unit. And once we realize that we are one unit, that whatever I'm doing to you is affecting. You know, with that understanding, we will change the way we are treating animals, the way we are harvesting them now, because that is literally what it is, isn't it? The way we are destroying the natural environment, all this will change, because we as human beings will change the way we're looking at the world, the way we want to see our world to progress. I think all of that will automatically, it will have such an impact, on how we're seeing and treating.
I think if we instigate this, if Article 25, or I'm going to say when Article 25 becomes fundamental law around the world, there's going to be such a massive shift in consciousness that we probably can't even imagine at the moment. Just the way we are with one another and with the world. Yes, so what's behind you?
Thank you. Gerald Hartley, Stroudman Party. The Article 25 statement there in the placard, presumably the everyone has to refer to future generations as well. And I'm just wondering if you have links already with Polly Higgins' Ecocide campaign.
If we have links with?
The Ecocide campaign. And this relates strongly back to what Clive was saying about economic growth, and also about the lady who was talking about the blood circulating in the body. Unfortunately, what's circulating in the body at the moment is not money, it's debt. So you can't ignore things like positive money and ecocide campaigns, because they just impact so strongly on that. And I just wonder if you've had any inputs yet on those subjects.
It's a very good question, but no one yet. Just the answer.
I'm just thinking, at the moment, it seems that we're going to need to have a real change in consciousness, in culture, because the way everything's going, money's being cut, so we might not be able to see this happening. But if we imagine in 5 or 10 years' time where, you know, we have artificial intelligence, meaning there's so much more robots doing different jobs, you know, driverless cars, you know, I think it is coming, and we are going to have potentially vast swathes of people not working. And for the current capitalist government or capitalist society that we live in, if that isn't going to completely change and get, you know, collapse, they are going to have to think of a way to look after all those people, because basically capitalism needs consumers, needs people to buy new products. So I do think, you know, we are going to have to think about new ways of doing things. It is difficult to see at this moment, maybe, for us because of the current climate, but I do think it has got potential, you know, in the future with what's going to happen with automation.
Thank you very much.
So, is there a website? Website.
Yes, we've got a stand out there. If you want to come and ask us anything else, we'll be around. We've got our books for sale and applications.
Okay.
Thank you.